To start in Psalms chapter 1 and bring the word of God to you today to help you to understand to live this blessed life, because God wants your life to erupt this year in the glory and the power of what he has for you. This is your year. Tell your neighbor, this is my year. I don't know what's going to happen to you this year, but this is my year. This is my year to come out head first. This is my year to have success on my life. This is my year to change some things. I'm putting old things away and everything's going to become new in my life. This year is going to be totally different than any life. So if you don't see the same person tomorrow after you hear this word, it's going to be okay, because I'm going to do something different in my life than I've ever done before. Someone shout amen there. Amen. Now you in Psalms chapter 1, and we're going to start in the first verse there. We're going to read a couple of these verses to give us some direction this morning in the word of God. And the word of God says this: blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the paths of sinners, nor sits in the seats of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the river of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaves who shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. Let's say that. Whatever he does shall prosper. That's what it is to live a blessed life. That whatever you do shall prosper, will prosper, will come to pass. It is a promise from God. These are one of these promises that God gives all his people for us to understand, that it will come to pass. It will happen. I will prosper in anything that I do because I am blessed of the Lord. Tell your neighbor, I am blessed of the Lord. Amen. I want us to look and understand that the Psalms here that we're looking at, David wrote this psalm, and David is a man who comes from a place in his life. He's just a common man. He's an ordinary man. He's a man like you and I. Amen. David wasn't born with a silver spoon in his mouth. He didn't have royalty in his blood. He was a sheep herder. He was out in the field. He didn't have anything going for him but living life day to day, just like everyone else in this room. But David knew something about God. David knew something about it. He wasn't, he may have been spiritually prepared, but socially and economically, he didn't have everything going for him in that way. So to say, oh, I'm blessed because I have a lot of money, I have a big house, I got all this car, I got a big business. David didn't have that. David was just a common man who lived life and knew his spiritual roots and how they were found, and lived his life out in the Lord. David knew who God was. He knew this opportunity to live in God. But David went through a transformation. Say transformation. David went through a transformation from a common man to the king of Israel. He was a common man out in the field taking care of sheep, and then God called him to be the king of Israel. Now that's a transformation. To being a nobody to being somebody. To having nothing, to having everything, and ruling over everything in your life. Now, that's a predicament in your life that all of us would want to do, but there's preparation in the process to get there. David had to learn how to trust in God and believe in the God so that he could live the blessed life for the things that were coming before him. So why am I saying this? What do I want to teach you about living this blessed life? Because I find it to be important in our lives that if you don't understand what it is to be blessed, then you're always going to live in the mess. If you don't know what it is to be blessed, then you're always going to think everything you do is still a mess. So I have to help you to understand that there is a blessing. And it's the purpose of that. Malachi 3:10 teaches us about the blessing. And what the blessing is, it tells us that if I, you know, it says that if I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing upon you. He teaches that through our tithing. He says, you know, if you tithe, then I'm going to open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing upon you that you won't contain. Now, many of us get confused in that text because we say, well, if I tithe, then I'm going to get all kind of money. Because you don't really understand what the blessing is. See, when you understand the blessing, you know that God will bless you when you do the right thing, then everything else in your life is taken care of. That's what the blessing is. That's what it means to be blessed, to understand that God sustains you in everything that you go through. Amen? That's the blessed life. So here is what a blessing is. A blessing is being the innate ability to succeed and overcome adversity. Get this, to be blessed is the innate ability to succeed and overcome adversity. To be blessed doesn't mean you're not going to go through something. To be blessed doesn't mean troubles won't come your way. To be blessed is know that you're going to be able to overcome whatever adversity comes your way in your life, that you can stand up and live and be okay and not lose your mind in the midst of that process. Come on, son. It's like having 9 lives. Even though they try to kill you, you keep coming back every time. It's like a cat. No matter how high you throw it, it seems to always land on its feet. So no matter what you go through, your life always seems to stand up upright because you're blessed. Somebody say, I'm blessed. That's the importance about being blessed, because you have the innate ability to overcome adversity in your life. That's why I can say I'm blessed. Not because of my bank account. You'd be afraid of my bank account. But I'm blessed because I can still survive. I'm blessed because I was able to get up this morning. I'm blessed because I'm able to live in the things that God has me, in the fullness of God's glory and his power and the willingness of the things that God has. Somebody shout amen right there. Amen. So blessed people do have adversity in their life. Blessed people do have troubles in their life. Blessed people go through things, but no matter what happens, they still stand. They're tenacious in the way they live their life. Amen? So we need to learn how to live this blessed life. You see, the blessing of God is kind of the same thing as like a curse. A curse and a blessing are kind of the same thing, because a curse and a blessing is about the end result. Let me talk to somebody over here. The curse and a blessing are all about the end result, not something that's happening right now. Let me help you with this. Jesus walks up to a fig tree with his disciples, and the fig tree is supposed to have produced some fruit in its season. It is supposed to have something in its season. And when Jesus comes to the tree and he finds that the tree does not have what it's supposed to be producing in its season, Jesus speaks a word and he curses the tree. But the tree just doesn't wither up and die right in front of everyone. His disciples walk away, and they come back the next day. And when they come to the tree, they find the end result of a word that was spoken. Something that was said now has changed and has an end result, not because it was something that was done in the beginning. So we see that also in the beginning in Genesis and with Adam and Eve. And God says, from the day you eat of this tree, you shall what? Surely die. Did they just drop dead in the garden right there at that moment? There was an end result of something that would come to happen. That's why we have sin in the world. So the curse of that, eating that tree, of doing that, has the end result of that has been the curses of this world and the problems we find ourselves in week after week, year after year, day after day, the problems of our life. So the curse has an end result in the things that we have, so doesn't the blessing. The blessing is something that comes after. That's why even Malachi 3:9 says this. You have been what? Cursed with a curse. You have been cursed with a curse because you haven't given your tithe. This curse that you're receiving, the trouble that you're going through in your life, is because you have chosen not to. And by the word, you're now receiving the thing that you would not do. Because you wouldn't receive the word, now you are cursed with a curse. So it's important for us to receive a word. That's why we need good word in our life. That's why we need things spoken that will edify, uplift, and exalt. You keep telling your husband he's a potato head, he's always going to be a potato head. There'll be the end result of that which you speak into him. Oh, I wish I can get just one person to agree with me. You have to understand the power of your words, the things you speak, the things you begin to say are the end result of that which you are doing. You don't like your life, you keep being broke, stop saying you're broke. Because you curse your finances. You curse your relationships. You curse these things, and then you get the end result, and you don't like the end result of the things you're saying or where you're at in your life. Are you following me? So the Bible teaches us that if we're going to live a life in the things of God, we speak to it so that that, whatever it is, the end result of it will be that which we have spoken to. That'll get some of you to stop talking about people. That'll get some of you to stop talking about your spouses and your relationships and the people you know. Amen? Because if you don't like your in-laws, stop talking about them. Start giving them some praise. Start saying some things about them, and that will change everything about it. Amen? So if you speak the curse, you get a curse. You speak the blessing, you're going to get a blessing in your life. Amen? So it doesn't matter what you do. We're all going to go through some adversity in our lives. We're all going to have troubles in our lives. We're all going to have some types of problems. But ultimately, we're going to be able to rise above the adversities of our lives because we're blessed. Somebody needs to just say to themselves, I'm blessed, I'm blessed, I'm blessed. You got to remind yourself that you're blessed and you'll get through the rest of whatever it is that you are doing. You will come out of the thing head first if you can see yourself as a blessed individual. You'll see yourself in the position that God has for you. So David is so blessed in his life that no matter what's thrown at him, David was chased by Saul. David was tried to be killed so many times and taken out by the sword, but David still survived. David was, was immoral. He didn't live a moral life. He did some things that weren't right in his life. David embarrassed himself, and he even embarrassed God. But David still was able to stand on his feet, live his life for God, give honor and glory to where glory was due, and he came out of every situation in his life head first because he was blessed. Not because of the adversity of his life, because of his ability to stay blessed in the things of God, was able to get him through whatever he was going through. Get him out of the dust of the field and get him into the palace of God. So if you ever find yourself in the dusty places of your life, in the adversity of your life, just remind yourself how blessed you are. God will get you through it. He'll get you to the other side of this situation. I don't care what has happened to you last year. This is your year. I don't care what you went through, but this is your year. I don't care how slow business was last year. This is going to be a better year. God's going to do more things for you. He's going to bring you to a new height. But you got to stay connected to the things of God. You got to stay connected to the things of God. Amen? David knew how to worship, and he was a true worshiper before God. And because of his worship, he worshiped his way through the problems of his life. See, us worshipers really understand that anytime we get in trouble, we just start singing. That's why they think we're crazy. Why are you singing in the midst of this? Man, I just got to give God all the praise for where I'm at. I understand what I'm at and what I'm going through, but I praise my way through my situation. To get on the other side of this, I give God some glory. I'm too blessed to be stressed in what's going on around me. I don't know about you, but you just got to bless somebody every now and then in your life. Tell somebody, be blessed, not stressed. Amen. You don't need to be stressed about this thing. God's going to get you through whatever it is that you're going through. But I'm here to let you know it's the adversities of your life that helps you to overcome and help you to recognize that you're blessed. So you should be celebrating your adversities. I told you we're crazy up here because we'd be thanking the problems that we're in. It's the problem. It's these things that you understand you're blessed because you're still surviving. You're still going through it. If you didn't have adversity, how would you know how good God was in your life? If you didn't go through anything, how do you know that there was a good God in the world? How do you know that you could trust God and believe in God if you never went through anything? That he wasn't there for you in your time of trouble, in your time of sorrow. So that's why we say, oh, good God, good God, good God. And yeah, they say you're crazy, but you know that he's good in the midst of your adversity. That's why we celebrate adversity and the problems of our lives and the things that we go through. Because when we do, we know that we can get out of it. We know even though it may get tough, it won't crush me. Even though I may be going through it, it will never destroy me. It may press me down, but it can't hold me down. I'm going to come out of this thing. I'm going to rise above it. At some point, you're going to see me come out of it. People don't want to see you come out of your problems, but this year is your year to come out of your problem. This is the year they're going to start talking about you. This is the year they're going to stop complaining about you, and you're going to show them the power and the glory of God. Who wants this to be their year? Ah, yes, 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 yes. But God says if you want to be aligned with his blessing, there are a couple of things that you have to do. First, you got to know him. You got to have a relationship with him. You got to come to know him as your Lord and Savior in your life. The second thing we saw in Malachi 3:10 is you have to tithe. Why tithe? Because tithing helps release the blessing upon your life. It's the only place in the whole Bible. Anywhere you read in the Bible says this is the only place where you can test God. Because he says, test me in this. It's the only place you'll find it. Nowhere. God says, test me in this and see not that I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing upon you that you cannot. You don't tithe so that you can get your car payment paid. You don't tithe so that your mortgage can get done. You don't tithe so that you can find $1 million scratch ticket somewhere. You don't tithe for those things. You tithe so that you can be blessed and a blessing can be poured out upon you so that you can receive that which whatever God has for you in your life so that you can maintain. Somebody say maintain. You want to be able to maintain a life of sanity. This is the year that you maintain a life of sanity. That you don't have to feel like you're losing your mind. Some of us can't afford to lose any more of this mind. I'm down to the last piece, and if I lose this, it's all over. If I give up this last thing that I have, I don't know what I'm going to do. I know you're in that boat. I'm in the same boat. Don't worry about that. But this is your year. This is your year to make a difference. This is your year to make a change. I don't care what you have done. I don't care where you've been in your life. I don't care what dirt you have done, but this year, God's saying, it doesn't matter what you've done. All you do is turn to me, and I'm going to bless your stress. I'm going to change it for your glory. I'm going to allow you to see that the best is still yet to come for your life. I don't care how old you are. God said, it's not over yet. I'm about to do a work. I had to get you to this place so I could bless you. I know you went through this and the ups and downs and the problems of kids and family. I know you went through all that stuff, but I had to get you there so I could get you right here. I had to get you to that place so I could get you to this place so that I could bless you. So that you would begin to understand the things that I have for your life. So we need to know that in order to do these things, David points out some things for us in this text. David points out several points to us that helps us to understand how to be blessed in our life. He tells us three don'ts to do, and he tells us something that we should do. Amen. So there's some don'ts. And one of the first don'ts is, as we read in verse 1, he says, don't walk in the counsel of the ungodly. Turn to your neighbor and say, don't walk in the counsel of the ungodly. Amen. So what he's saying to us is that I will not bless you. Get this. He says, I will not bless you if you are listening to the world. If you're listening to secular counseling about your life. If you are listening to the world of how you're going to live and how you're supposed to live. You are not going to receive the blessing. You cannot walk in the counsel of the ungodly. You cannot walk in your natural sense. You have to walk in the spiritual things of God, and understanding God's word is how we get through these things and how we understand spiritual understandings for all our lives. It is through the word of God. Amen. We need to live in the word of God, not become vulnerable to this world. You cannot let the world speak to you. I'm talking to somebody right now. You keep going to the world. You keep going to the news. You keep going everywhere else to hear information for your life when you're getting the wrong information for what God wants to do for your life. I got to help somebody here today. And this is your year to be blessed. And if you're going to be blessed, you cannot get counsel from the world. You got to stop YouTubing it. You got to stop Googling it. You can't find it there. You must find it under the spiritual guidance of God. If you want to change your life, only God knows about your life. Your neighbor knows junk about you, but they don't know everything about you. Everyone in your family wants to talk about you, but they don't know the real you. I know your mama birthed you, and she thinks she knows everything about you, but she doesn't know how uniquely designed you were for God and the purpose and the intents of God upon your life. So you don't have to listen to the counsel of the world. You must listen to the counsel of God. And so many of us find ourselves vulnerable to the world, listening to ungodliness in our lives, and then challenge the word of God against ungodliness. Oh, my God. I'm telling you, many of us are following the trends of the world. Our hearts right now, many of us are thinking where we're going after this in the world. How we're going to support the world. How we're going to live in this world. Well, Pastor, I live in it. It says, yes, we live in this world, but what? We're not of this world. You live here, but you're not of it. So you can't think what the world is doing. You can't follow its trends. You can't follow its patterns, because what they do is not for you. God has another road of success for you. He has another plan. I know I'm in the midst of everyone else doing things, but God doesn't have me on the, I know it looks like we're on the same road, but we're not. I'm on another level. I'm on a whole different level than everybody else. Not because I'm special, but because I'm blessed. Not because I have anything more than you have, but because I'm blessed. God's bringing me down the road in the destiny of my life. And there's a road I got to be on. It's a place I got to go. And you may not be able to get on the road that I'm going, because God has a plan for me. That's what it is about being blessed in your life. But you can't keep listening to the chatter. You can't keep listening to what other people are saying. You have to listen to the voice of God. You have to listen to godly counsel. So on this level, you can't be advised by the world, but you have to be advised by God. And it's important to remember this in Romans 12. Romans 12, 2, what does it remind us to do? It says, and do not be what? Conformed to this world, but be ye what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I think we need to read that again. Follow me here. Romans 12, chapter 2, if you want to write it down, you can get there. Get there on your app. Get there somehow. It says, do not be conformed to this world. It means don't let the structure of this world wrap itself around you. To come in conform with the world is to follow that which it's doing. Don't be conformed by that, but to be transformed by the what? You're going to have to renew your mind, the way you think about things. The way you approach things, how you're going to approach business this year. You're going to transform your mind about doing that. The relationships that you're involved in, you're going to have to rethink how you're going to approach that and transform the way you think about them. The way you think about your family, the way you think about your church, the way you think about your job. This year is your year to transform your mind. You need to renew it. That what? That you may prove. When there's transformation, there's a proof behind it. Isn't God so good that he'll prove that he's good in your life? Say, that's a shouting moment. That's a moment where you throw your weave on the floor and say, I don't need this thing anymore, because, you know, God's going to do something for me. I wish I had some weaves up here right now. You got to understand, it's just that moment where you, God says, I'm going to prove it in your life that it can be done. God says, I can do it, but you can't. God is the God of the impossible. The thing you can't do is the thing that God wants to do. The thing you can't overcome is the thing that God wants to overcome in your life. Some of us have some deep struggles in our life. Amen for the struggle. God said, I'm glad you can't do it. That allows me access into your life to overcome that thing that you can't do. That gives me the ability to bring transformational change for you. Give you a hope and a future, because you can't do it. You believe that I can do it in you and through you. And why? I'm going to prove it. I don't know who read their word like I'm going to just read it. It says, it will prove to you what is good and acceptable. Because God will remind you what's good and acceptable in your life. And what? The perfect will of God. Does anyone ever want to do the will of God? Have you always just, you know, you're still trying to figure out what's God's will? What's God's will for my life? What's God's will for my life? God said, if you change your mind, you'll understand what my will is for your life. If you just renew the way you think about this whole thing, I'll change everything in your life. See, God's saying, if you do something in your life, then you're going to reap the benefits of the glory in your life. And I'm going to prove that to you. I'm going to prove it to you. And that's very important for us to understand that. So we can't conform or shape ourselves around the things of the world. So this year, you're going to say, how have I been conforming to the things of the world? And this year, I'm going to change that. I'm changing my thought patterns. I'm changing my perspective of how I've looked at things or looked at other people. You know, so someone would say, do you know that person? Has anyone ever said that to you? Do you know that person? And then you start giving them the rundown. And when you give them a rundown, where does it go? Right up into their head. And they start to form an image of that person because of what you said. And then that person gets a distorted image because you don't like them for something. Now their image is distorted, and now you start to not like them because of what somebody else, oh, I wish somebody really got that, what somebody else said. Who are you going to listen to? Are you going to listen to the voice of God, or are you going to listen to the voice of the world? So don't move in formation and alignment with the world. Whatever the world is doing, don't do. Do what God's calling you to do. Amen? And the problem is there are many of us in the church today who feed on the world. Just because people come to church don't mean they eat on the things of God. People come to church and they do the world. Sunday's the only day that they focus on God. Sunday's the only day. Every other day, everything that they do, they're conformed to the world. How do I know that? Thank you for asking me. Because when you ask them midweek, can you help doing this? No, I have to work. No, I have a family function. No, I have to do this. They're conforming to what? Secular people, secular jobs, everything else that has nothing to do with the kingdom of God. So it tells me that in their own lives, they are more conformed to the things of the world than they are to the things of God. Now, should we not be with our family? I'm not saying no. Should we not go to work? I'm not saying that you don't go to work. But I'm saying when you start thinking in your mind that these are the more important things, it's saying you are conformed and you have the world's understanding or the philosophy of what they believe. And now what happens when you start to believe those things? Now, wherever you go, you start to bring your belief system with you. So whatever the world tells you, you bring it to church and you start telling the preacher what he should do by your belief in the world. See, I don't know where you get your belief, but I get my belief from the word. I get my belief from God. What God says goes. It's not because I don't want it to happen. Hey, God says it. I have to believe it. I don't want to fight against what he said, because that's why I got in this thing, because I couldn't figure this world thing out on my own. I tried. I failed every time. I wasn't successful because of him. Him not being in my life. So I said I had to conform to a new way of life. I can't conform to the things of the world or society or this is the right thing, or let's vote and see if this is right. And no, that's conforming to the things of the world. So when we vote no. Why? Because God said it's not the right thing to do because of what? The outcome. It's not the present state. It's the outcome. We say no because of the outcome. We don't say no to people. We say no to the sin that people are doing. We don't say no to people. We love everybody. Crackhead, crazy, divorced, dysfunctional. It don't matter. We love you. Maybe the thing you're doing we don't like, but we love you.
I want to thank you again as the senior pastor of the Answer Four Square Church that you have taken this opportunity, your time, to sit down and hear the word of God. It is the empowerment of God's glory that we would come together as brothers and sisters in Christ in the fellowship of the saints to hear God's word together and to hear great preaching and teaching that would help us to grow. If you're watching this message each week, it is letting us know that God is transforming and changing your life. Come and visit us. Be a part of the kingdom of God and the community that God has at the Answer Four Square Church for you, because it's living and loving God, loving others, and making disciples as we go. God bless you. Until next time, have a great and wonderful day.